We have a guest from Ishgard who wishes to speak with you. I believe the two of you have met.
We have. I had hoped to speak with Commander Leveilleur as well, but I cannot afford to wait any longer. The Lord Commander sent me hither to request your aid in a matter of grave import.
You see now why I had Tataru summon you.
Now that we're all assembled, perhaps you would be good enough to elaborate on the nature of the matter which brought you to us.
The Observatorium's astrologians have sounded the alarum. Last night, the Dragonstar burned with an intensity not seen in 15 summers. Not since the Dravanians engaged the Empire in the Battle of Silvertear Skies.
The northern sky doth burn full bright upon the Wormlord's call. The red behemoth beckoneth, and flame consumeth all.
The old Curthan rhyme, aye. The brightening of the dragon's eye is said to accompany the roar of a great worm. The astrologians believe that it was Midgard Soma himself who cried out on this occasion.
After an absence of centuries, the King of Kings did return to lead his kind against the might of Garlemald, only to fall in his duel with the Agrius, proud flagship of the Garlean fleet. Devoid of life, his corpse remaineth entwined about the Magitek monstrosity even unto this day.
Ariange has the right of it. Whatever this alteration in the Dragonstar portends, the Great Worm has shown no sign of life. Tataru, have the Domans reported aught out of the ordinary?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but if Midgard Soma had roared, wouldn't we have heard it here in Revenant's Toll?
Roar is but a figure of speech. Dravanians can communicate in ways beyond our ken. It is for this very reason that we are forced to look for signs in the heavens. We cannot say with any confidence that a great worm roared at all, much less that it was Midgard Soma. Only by directly examining the Keeper of the Lake can we be certain. However, it will take too long to gain the Holy See's approval to dispatch the Temple Knights. Therefore, Sir Emrick would entrust this task to you. Do you accept? We knew you would not disappoint us. Now, if you would excuse me, I must return and assist the Lord Commander. We have precious little time to prepare.
To prepare for what, pray tell?
When a great worm roars, his brethren cannot choose but answer. We prepare for battle.
Who treadeth now upon my bones, and waketh me from slumber sweet?
Thank you.
By her gifts hast thou earned a moment's reprieve. Speak, mortal, and I shall listen. Guided by a star. My people have heard the song. Ishgard shall burn. Sons must answer for their father's misdeeds. We do not forget. We do not forgive. Seven children did I sire, one now singeth of retribution. I rise to join in the chorus. Thou art powerless to silence us, mortal. Yet thou shalt not live to labor in vain. Thy reprieve is at an end. Trickery is thy shield. This frail, noble creature is not gifted, but chosen. Hearken to me, Hydalin. I remember, and I consent. Fear not, mortal. I shall not harm thee. Thinkest me an oath breaker? Thou art mistaken if thou comest to harm. It shall be by another's hand, not mine. did but strip thee of thy mistress's feeble blessing. Thou didst profit much by her grace, but no more.
My friend, I can scarce believe it. You confronted the Wormlord and lived to tell the tale. I give thanks to Helone for your preservation. It is our sole cause for gladness. Your encounter with the Keeper of the Lake served to confirm our fears. A great worm has roared, and it makes little difference if it was one of the two in Eorzea or any other. The Dravanians are coming.
I am told that Ishgard has magical defenses against Dravanian attack, though I am not privy to their exact nature. Will they be enough to repel a massive force?
Ishgard has weathered countless assaults over centuries. This will be no different. And now that you have confirmed the threat, none can ignore the Lord Commander's calls for the wards to be strengthened. I dare not presume to speak for him, but I expect the Lord Commander would sing your praises. I must away, but we shall meet again soon.
Countless assaults weathered, and this will be no different? Why am I not convinced? Thank you.
Now that everything's calmed down a bit, relatively speaking, I mean, I thought it might be a good time to share our progress on the weapon. I believe we're on the verge of a breakthrough.
Well, don't keep us all in suspense.
Just in case anyone's forgotten, let's start by reviewing what we already know. So, an Arcian is an immortal because its soul doesn't return to the ethereal realm when its host is defeated. Instead, it flees to the place that lies between our world and the Void. Therefore, the first step to permanently defeating an Arcian is preventing its soul from making this journey. And if you recall, when we last gathered here, I had verified that White Aurasite has adequate capacity to entrap the beings, albeit only briefly.
Which left the small matter of their extermination.
Aye. To unmake an Arcian's soul, one must needs smite it with a concentrated burst, or blade, of purest ether. However, we wanted for both the data and the means to forge such a weapon.
Short of experimenting on an actual Arcian, you see, there's no way to gauge how much ether its soul is made of. As such, we don't know what etheric density our blade needs to have in order for it to work.
So we'll just have to make the densest blade we can and hope for the best. Though, that would require a lot of ether. Hang on a minute! Why didn't we think of this before? White Aurasite can hold an absolute heap of ether, can't it?
Please tell me you're joking! God's sakes, Ida! I feel as though I'm reliving the same scene over and over with you. How many times do you need to be told that White Aurasite cannot store ether for long periods? Being intangible matter, ether is given to dispersion. Only in its crystallized form is it a stable source of energy. I will test you later on this, so see to it you do not forget!
Right, yes. It's all coming back to me.
So our hopes rest on good old crystals again, do they? While they are certainly reliable, they leave something to be desired in the area of portability.
Indeed. I am reminded of the quantity of corrupted crystals required to thwart Leviathan, and the extraordinary lengths to which the Lominsons went to transport them. What if it should prove that a similar quantity was needed to destroy an Arcian soul, or still more?
I do not envy the poor sod who has to lug all of that around, on the off chance that an Arcian appears.
That's the very problem we set out to solve, and I reckon we've found the answer. If it isn't practical to lug around the ether we need, we'll just have to draw upon another source. And the only viable source is the land.
If you mean to tap the Great River of Aether, know that it will entail considerable risk. Meddling with the currents may well induce a surge like to the one which despoiled Mordona.
Give me a bit more credit, will you? Why would we need to tap the river when there are veritable reservoirs jutting out all over the land? Aye, I speak of corrupted crystals. It might be that their aspect is out of balance, but a crystal's a crystal. It contains ether, and we can help ourselves to it.
While corrupted crystals are indeed abundant, there is no guarantee that they will be in close proximity at a crucial moment.
But what if we don't need them to be? What if we could tap their power from afar? A malm away, say? If we could do that, we'd have ready access to ether aplenty in almost every corner of Eorzea. I've yet to put my theories to the proof, but I've got a good feeling about this. If no one has any objections, I'd like to see where this avenue leads.
If you think it worth your while, you have my blessing. But tell us, what are your theories? I, for one, am most eager to understand the process, however vaguely.
I thought you might say that, but no one wants to listen to boring old theories all day, do they? I know I don't. So with your permission, I'd like to try something a bit more hands-on. I've already built an etheric siphon especially for this purpose, and I've been meaning to try it out. Thing is, the profusion of corrupted crystals in Mordona makes it something of a high-risk testing ground. If anything goes awry with the siphon, it would be better if it didn't happen within spitting distance of quite so much ether. Ideally, I need an isolated specimen. Does anyone know where I can find one?
May I suggest Northern Thanalan? There you will find corrupted crystals of middling size, standing a reasonable distance apart. Ideal for your needs, I should have thought. Oh, and if you do elect to visit the place, I should be much obliged if you would assist me in another matter while you are in the area.
Has something happened?
Movement has been observed at Castrum Meridianum. During Operation Archon, the Alliance dealt the Stronghold a heavy blow. Its facilities were extensively damaged, and its garrison reduced to a fraction of its former strength. Not long after our forces withdrew, however, their ranks were replenished by reinforcements from Castrum Sentry. They now seek to rebuild, and to this end, they have their sights set upon the Ceruleum processing plant. Having lost the Empire's support, the 14th Legion lacks the resources to sustain itself. To them, this is a bid for survival, and they will doubtless fight like desperate men. Though I have dispatched the Crystal Braves, I fear their strength alone may not suffice to stay the Imperial assault. I would request the Scion's aid in the defensive effort.
If I didn't know better, I'd say you were trying to inveigle us into fighting your battle with the promise of shiny crystals. Well then, consider me inveigled. I won't lie, the crystals you speak of sound perfect, so the Garlians have to go. Besides, we can't afford to beat about the bush. There's no telling when the Arcians will next appear.
Thine eagerness to hurl thyself into the jaws of danger cometh as little surprise. Exercise due caution, I prithee.
Though you have become a Crystal Brave, you are yet a Scion, Alfino. We could hardly refuse you. Pray, join the Crystal Braves and lend them your support. Thangrid and Papalimo shall accompany you. Ida and Yashtola, in the meantime I would have you assist Moonbreeder. Scout out the crystal clusters, that the testing may commence as soon as the Garlian threat has been eliminated.
If it please you, I shall continue mine own experiments on white aurasite.
Thank you, Arianger. Everyone, pray see to your preparations and depart as soon as you're able. Go well. And be safe.